I'm just talking. Greetings. Happy Wednesday. Happy Women's History Month. My name is Diana Vega, and I am Civic Engagement Coordinator for DC Public Library. And we want to welcome you all to a wonderful Women's History Month event we have planned for today. We have, it's just a program. I want to say an author talk, but it's much more than that. But we're welcoming author Tamara Winfrey-Harris. She's the author of the new book, Dear Black Girl, Letters from Your Sisters on Stepping into Your Power. And she will be in conversation with one of the book's contributors, Aishah Shahidah Simmons. And then we're going to bring in two teens from our teen council to join them in conversation. And then we're going to open it up to you, the audience. If you have any questions as the program goes along, please put them in the chat. So it's going to be a wonderful program. I'm already excited. I'm going to tell you a little bit about who you're going to hear from. First up is author of Dear Black Girl, Tamara Winfrey-Harris. She's a writer who specializes in the ever-evolving space where current events, politics, and pop culture intersect with race and gender. She has been published in several media outlets, including the New York Times, The Atlantic, Cosmopolitan, and the Los Angeles Times. Her first book, The Sisters Are All Right, Changing the Broken Narrative of Black Women in America, was published in 2015. She's also the co-founder of Centering Sisters, LLC, an organization that unapologetically addresses the needs and issues of Black women, girls, and femmes. Tamara is a native of Gary, Indiana. She's a proud member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, Incorporated, and she graduated with a BA from Greenlee School of Journalism at Iowa State University. So we are welcoming Tamara. And then our a contributor to Dear Black Girl, Aishah Shahidah Simmons, is an award-winning Black feminist, lesbian cultural worker who for over 25 years has examined the intersections of race, gender, sexuality, and sexual violence. Her creative work, published writings, international lectures, and independent scholarship are informed by her lived experiences as a child sexual abuse survivor, adult rape survivor, and Buddhist practitioner committed to healing, accountability, and compassionate justice. She was one of 19 recipients of the 2020 Searles Justice Fellowship, and she's begun a two-year training program to become a mindfulness meditation teacher, which she views as a continuation of her long-term Buddhist practice. She is originally from Philadelphia, but Aishah resides here in DC. Yay! So I'm gonna bring up Tamara and Aishah. They're gonna talk about Dear Black Girl, what's it all about? And then we're gonna bring in the teens. And if you have any questions and comments, please put them in the chat throughout the program. Welcome, Tamara. Welcome, Aishah. Hello, hello. I'm gonna turn it over to you all. Thank you for joining us.
It would help if I wasn't muted.
That was me earlier. Thank you for joining us. I'm gonna turn it over to you both.
Thank you.
How excited am I to be doing this with you? Like, she was reading your bio. Well, one, I was looking at you going, I need to step up my game because you got the lipstick rocket and all of that. So,
if you could have seen me about 25 minutes ago, I was like, I got to do something. Let me put a shawl and make.
But two, I was like, ooh, I need to talk to Aishah about a bunch of things that, we need Zoom time. Soon.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Let's do that. But I'm just so excited about this book. It's such a gift and that I am giving to nieces and younger cousins and younger sisters. This is amazing. So, yeah.
Thank you. I thought maybe that we could start. I like to start by reading a little bit from the preface because it kind of centers and explains why I wanted to write the book. And part of it was driven by what I was hearing from Black girls that I talked to. So if I might share to kick us off.
Please.
The preface is called We Are All Right. My Black Girls, You Tell Me Things. You tell me how you love your mamas, but kind of hate them too. You tell me about the boys at school who text dirty messages. You tell me about beauty insecurities, the too big noses and five heads. You tell me who you like, showing me pictures of boys on IG and giggling, ain't he cute? You tell me these things and I smile. And it's been a while since I was a girl, but I remember hating my parents' rules and being insecure about my looks. I remember the trifling boys and super fine crushes. Some things about Black girlhood never change. You tell me other things too. You tell me about anxiety or depression that will not let go. You tell me about social media memes that leave you feeling demeaned and hated. You tell me about boys and men who violate you and families who cannot deal with the devastation of sexual assault. You tell me about carrying the burden of friends and family who have been murdered. You tell me about families who cannot accept your queer identity. You tell me about schools that suspend you for petty reasons. You tell me how people assume you are angry, unfeminine, grown, and hypersexual before you can even find out who you are for yourself. You tell me these things and I worry. I remember that the world does not value Black girls like it should. Some things that are too common in Black girlhood must change.
I just got to say, as someone who will be 52 in less than a month, I needed this book. I needed this book when I was a Black girl. And I'm happy to have it as a Black woman, but I really, this is such a profound gift that you're offering to Black girls everywhere. And I'm really honored that you really were like, Aishah, you got to write something. Because I was like, I can't. I'm packing. I'm moving to D.C. I don't, in a pandemic, I don't have time. And I got to tell you, if I hadn't have done it, I mean, you know, there are plenty of sisters who could have written, so I don't want to act like I'm the only person. I would have been really sad not to have my voice included, because I feel like it is a letter to all, but it's also a letter to my Black girl self.
I love that. And that's kind of what I've been saying, is that I feel like we as Black women, like we all still carry, little Tammy is still in there with all her like triumphs and unresolved hurts and, you know, all of those things. And this reading this book, putting this book together was truly cathartic for me. And I'm so happy that you agreed to be in it, because I just think of you as this loving voice. And, you know, someone asked me what I wanted girls to take away from this book. And it was that, is that I want them to feel loved, and I want them to feel loved in all the ways they show up in the world, all of the ways, and the ways that they actually authentically are, and not how they or we would prefer they be.
Yeah. And what I, as a queer woman, I'm really appreciative of how inclusive you are, you know, because in terms of just the wide spectrum of what Black girlhood looks like, it's queer, straight, it's, you know, not necessarily feminine, not necessarily masculine, you know, and you really encapsulate just a wide range of voices, so that, you know, and of course we can't have every single voice, but there's just such a diversity that, again, that's why I said, I wish, where was this book? Like when I was struggling with sexuality, just so much stuff that it just would have been wonderful to read letters from big sister friends who I wouldn't know, but would know through their letters.
Right. It's like the statement, which I say in the epilogue, is that, you know, you are not wrong. And that's what I want, girls. You are not wrong. Whoever you are, whatever you have going on, you are not wrong.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Wow.
It was, I wonder, is there a process? So like the book, for those of you who don't know, is more than 30 letters from Black women to Black girls. And I asked Black women to be vulnerable, to approach girls from a place of vulnerability and love. Because I think sometimes because of our fear, you know, we are scared for Black girls. We know that they don't get a lot of second chances. We know they don't get a lot of grace. We know how they are judged in this society as they become Black women. And so we want to, you know, we want to scold them into doing what will be acceptable by society, because we hope that then they will be okay. That doesn't work. It doesn't work. So like, was it hard for you to get, like, what is the process you went through to write this letter? And was it hard for you to find that place?
I think it was hard. You know, I was thinking about that as I was looking. I think it was, I talk about sexual violence a lot, and as a filmmaker and a writer, I've written about it. But really, I think framing the letter to someone significantly younger than me is a very different mindset. So it did take me. I had to go back there because my letter is in survivor solidarity. So I wanted to go back to the young, at that point I was a sophomore in college, but just all, you know, just that young girl, well, I was a late teenager in terms of what was going on. So, and I mean, I think that was the driving force, because I'm telling you, I was surrounded by boxes when you were like, Aishah, please. And I was like, no, I got it. And then I just thought about, like, what would it have been like had you received a letter like this, you know, what would, so that for me was a driving force to really think about what are the messages that I wish I had heard. And especially from someone who has been through it, not like this kind of theoretical thing, but yeah, like, hey, I'm on the other side of this, and it may feel like the end of the world right now. And it is a journey, an ongoing journey, but, you know, I'm like, just let me reach my hand across that ocean of misery to say, you can do this.
I think that's important, because I also think that's another thing that's sometimes hard when we're relating to even each other, but also Black girls, because we are so used to keeping up this facade of perfection, because that's what protects us in this society. And so even when we want to say, this happened to me, and therefore, and let me tell you what happened to me, we don't. And so,
right,
you know, there are so many women in the book who talk about, you know, dealing with their biracial identity, dealing with growing up as a dark brown-skinned woman, dealing with, you know, friendships that fail or thrive, or dealing with being pregnant at 16, dealing with sexual assault, you know, all of living in poverty, all of those things. But I thought it was important for them to come from a space of, this was me, not theoretical. This is what happened to me.
Mm-hmm. And I know so many peers who either have children or have children, and they even though they've been through a lot, they feel like, oh, I don't want to tell her this because, yeah, I, you know, she shouldn't know that. And I'm just like, why wouldn't you tell her? You, yes. Why, like, why not? Like, so you're right about that kind of, I just got it. No, she doesn't need to know that. I've heard people say, I don't want her using that as an excuse. Well, you did. And it's just like, no, this is, yeah, like, knowledge is power. And, you know, yes. And yeah. And so let's let our younger sisters, younger siblings know, you know, so that they don't, you know, there's going to be pitfalls on the journey. It's impossible to avoid them, but they don't have to fall into the same pitfalls that we fell in.
Yes. I'm so honored that Tarana Burke was willing to lend her endorsement to the book, But yes. as I've been having these conversations, I realized that her whole movement was sparked by, you know, she has said that a girl, I mean, she said it was 13, was telling her about being sexually abused, and she wondered why she did not say, me too. Like, right. That is the thing that is really hard for us to say. So, would you read your letter?
I would. I would be, it'd be my honor. Thank you. So it's called In Survivor Solidarity. I am writing to you from the other side of experiencing sexual violence. I am a Black feminist lesbian incest survivor, child sexual abuse survivor, and young adult rape survivor. When I was 10 years old, I was molested for 2 years by my pop-pop. I told my parents, but they never addressed it. Around the same time, a family friend rubbed my body without my consent. I was 11-ish and he was 23. I had a big crush on him. I loved receiving special age-appropriate attention from him, but I didn't like it when he touched my body. When I told my father's girlfriend that he had touched my body and also came into the bathroom when I took a shower to beg me not to tell anyone, she immediately told my father, who made him move out of our house immediately. Unfortunately, however, my divorced parents told me that though the family friend touching my body was wrong, it was my fault because I flirted with him. It wasn't until many years later when my first therapist told me that him touching my body wasn't my fault because I was a child and he was an adult. I was raped when I was 19 years old in my second year in college when I was on a study abroad program. I broke all the university rules to go out very late at night with the man who would become my rapist. Despite my having second thoughts about going out with this new acquaintance, I was both afraid to articulate them and to turn around because my friends were covering for me. Now, this was in 1989, years before everyone had a cell phone and before social media existed. We would all get in trouble if I returned after curfew. So I had to stay out all night until I could sneak back in the morning. In the hotel room for which I paid, I told my rapist, I didn't want to do this. Please stop. I didn't violently fight back. I didn't scream or yell to the top of my lungs because I was afraid. I didn't want to make a scene. I blamed myself for saying yes, for breaking the rules, for paying for the hotel room. The morning following my rape, I went back to the school that where the school housed us, and I lied to my friends. I didn't tell them that he forced me to have sex against my will. I had pleasurable consensual sex with another man less than 24 hours after my rape. For a brief moment in time during that sexual encounter, I denied what happened on the other night of my rape. I was also in control of my body again after the rape. When it was time to return home to the United States, I was pregnant. I didn't know which of the two men was the biological father, the rapist, or my one-night stand lover. I was fortunate to have a safe and legal abortion at the former Elizabeth Blackwell Health Center for Women in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. I am not a lesbian because I was molested and raped. I am a lesbian because I'm attracted to and love women. I have not lived your experience, and you are not alone. For over 40 years, I have journeyed from a victim of child sexual abuse, other forms of sexual assault and rape, to a survivor of these violations committed against my body without my consent. Here are a few essential things that I want you to know. First, if you are underage and the person who committed sexual harm is an adult or significantly older than you by 3 to 5 years, you cannot consent to sex, even if you really like the person and want to be sexually involved. Second, if you are sexually active, sexual desire isn't wrong. Rape and other forms of sexual violence are wrong. Third, you are not a slut, a hoochie, a fast, a hoe, a whore, or a thot, that hoe over there, a chicken head, a side chick, or any other derogatory word for Black girls and femmes who are sexually assaulted and raped. You did not get what you deserve. No one deserves to get raped or sexually assaulted. No one. Rape and other forms of sexual violence are vicious forms of terrorism where our bodies are violated and invaded against our will. Regardless of what anyone tells you, you should not be ashamed or blame yourself for the violence committed against your body. 4, sexual violence transcends your gender identity and sexual orientation. It doesn't matter if you're heterosexual or lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, or intersex. Any sexual violence you experience is not your fault. 5, there isn't anything that you can do that results in anyone touching any part of your body against your will. You have the right to say no. You are allowed to have crushes. You can flirt and even tease. You should have the right to wear what you want. You can kiss and participate in heavy petting, but decide that you don't want to have oral, vaginal, or anal sex. You can participate in oral sex, but do not want to have anal sex. You can say yes to all sexual activity and change your mind in the middle of the sexual activity. 6, you don't owe anyone sex because they give you special attention, take you out on a date, buy you food, or give you gifts. And 7, and perhaps most importantly, healing is a long-term journey and never a destination. Please be patient with yourself, and hopefully you can seek and receive the support you need. If not, let my words serve as a balm to your wounds and also as an affirmation of your survivor journey. And survivor solidarity always. Aishah.
That was wonderful. That was absolutely wonderful. And like it was important to me to have a Black woman write about sexual assault in the book, and hopefully that it be you, because we know that 60% of Black girls will experience sexual assault before they're 18, but we like to pretend that it's something that doesn't happen. We don't like to talk about it. And so those girls have to suffer in silence sometimes.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And I've been working on violence against women issues since 94 with my film, Know the Rape documentary, and now my anthology, Love with Accountability, digging up the roots of childhood sexual abuse. And we still, I think, you know, all communities, no one wants to talk about sexual violence. So across the board. And then I think as Black people, there's a need to kind of protect our community because we're dealing with so much in terms of racialized violence committed against the community. And I always say we have to do both. We have to address what's happening against our communities, but we must address what's happening within our communities. Because if racism ended right now, and we all wish it did, there's so many of us who still wouldn't be safe in our communities, in our homes, in our schools.
If, you know, one of the things that you will find in the book is at the end of these chapters, and particularly in the chapter where this letter exists, the tough stuff chapter that talks about things like poverty and sexual assault and teenage pregnancy and incarceration, there are resources, you know, access to resources, numbers that girls can call. And if you visit my website, which is TamaraWinfreyHarris.com, there's a free downloadable reader experience kit. And in that kit, there are questions that can help you if there are caregivers of Black girls, so, you know, mothers, aunties, teachers that want to have more in-depth conversations around some of these issues, that, you know, additional questions you can ask, but also guidelines to having good intergenerational conversation. I work with both an educator and a psychologist because there's sometimes some power dynamics there. And so when we start talking about these issues and you're talking with your parent who has power over you, we just want to make sure that you're having safe conversations and fruitful conversations around these issues. And there's also fun stuff. There are paper dolls and a really neat playlist, but some support to help you have this conversation.
And I just got to say what I mean, there's so many things I love about Dear Black Girl, but that you cover so much. Like, so and I think it is important for us to talk about the heavy issues because no one wants to talk about them, but you really cover the waterfront, I feel like, you know, kind of in terms of, you know, just the spectrum and all of, you know, the Black girl joy, all of it. So I think it's it's a map in terms of what life is about, you know, and I really appreciate that. And I appreciate the resources at the end and of each chapter, like, you know this or resources. So I think it's, and it's a wonderful, I mean, particularly now as we're all sheltering in place, I think it's a wonderful opportunity for people to have, for young people to have book clubs and talk about some of the issues. And particularly now that you're sharing about your resource guide on your website, that there's an opportunity for a lot of, you know, kind of cross-national even conversations that might not happen if we weren't in this, you know, virtual age of everybody kind of sheltering, and most people sheltering in place.
I go back and read like some of the letters that are just around inspiration. That, you know, there was one woman, I think she wrote that we are magic light and stars in the universe, and sometimes I'm like, I sure am. Like, sometimes you just need to hear that in the morning.
I am
great.
right. Yeah, because so often so many Black girls and even Black women, we don't hear that. So this is such, it's a praise song. It's a praise song.
I am so excited because we get to be interviewed by two Black girls today. And so I thought I would share, I would close out our part of talking to each other by reading from the epilogue of Dear Black Girl. But before I do, I wanted to give you a chance to, how can people find your work? Because your work is so important. So
thank you. My film, Know the Rape Documentary, and that's notherapedocumentary.org, is available for streaming on Vimeo demand for $1. So if you go to notherapedocumentary.org, all things about the film are there. And then lovewithaccountability.com is about the anthology. So those are the two big places. And also I'm on social media at AfroLez, at Twitter, AfroLez, and Instagram, AfroLez, AFROLEZ. So I look forward to being a continued conversation and community. Thank you.
So the epilogue is called Pick Up Your Oyster Knife. And if you don't recognize that Zora Neale Hurston reference, then I suggest you go to the DC Public Library and check out some books by Zora Neale Hurston. I love you, Black girl. I love Black girls in Afro puffs and Black girls in bundles of Remy. I love the daddy's girls and the fatherless ones. I love the little girls who make straight A's and the ones who skip school. I love the hood girls and the suburban girls and the country girls too. I love the quiet girls and the loud girls, the lip smacking, smart talking ones. I love the saved girls and the heathen ones. I love the girls who stay in sweatshirts and J's and the ones in the tight Fashion Nova fits. I love the happy girls and the anxious girls and the girls battling depression. I love the trans girls living defiantly. I love the girls in the library and the ones on the basketball court. I love the virgins and the young mamas. I love the girly girls and the butch girls. I love the girls who fight. I love the girls who love boys and the girls who love girls and the girls who love both or neither. I love you, Black girl, unconditionally, and whether you are 15 or 50. You hear me today? I love you, whether you look or act like they say you should. You are not wrong. And when you are wrong, I love you with all your flaws, no matter what choices and mistakes you have made, no matter where you live, no matter what you look like, no matter what thing has happened to you. And the greatest thing you can learn is to love yourself unconditionally too. It may be the hardest thing you have to learn. And I hope the letters in this book have shown you how. One other thing, Black girl, you must learn to love other Black women and girls the same way. Love us whether we look or act like they say we should. We are not wrong. And when we are wrong, love us with all our flaws, no matter what choices and mistakes we have made, no matter where we live, no matter what we look like, no matter what thing has happened to us. This does not mean you have to become a target for another Black girl's pain or anger or trauma. Doesn't mean you have to silence yourself in the face of Black women. It means you must give your sisters grace and understanding, the benefit of the doubt. So few people give us that. We owe it to each other. We have to acknowledge each other's humanity, even, maybe especially, when we are walking away. I hope the letters in this book have shown you how to do that too. Because we are sisters, Black girl. We have to take care of ourselves and each other. You are me, I am you, and we are all right. Inside each of us are tiny pieces of our foremothers. Sarah Boone's ingenuity, Danielle Luna's unforgettable beauty, Toni Morrison's incomparable wisdom, Mamie Till's fierce love, Aretha Franklin's creativity, Marsha P. Johnson's fearlessness, Harriet Tubman's will to survive, Katherine Johnson's genius, Michelle Obama's grace. Black girls are made up of all that magic, birthed in the African sun, baptized by the Middle Passage, and burnished by America. That is power that no one else can claim, just us. We are sisters, you are me, I am you, and we will get free together. Zora Neale Hurston, who's a great Black woman writer, once said, "I do not weep at the world. I am too busy sharpening my oyster knife." An oyster knife is a utensil used to crack open the shell of an oyster to get the tasty meat inside. Zora meant that she wasn't wasting time thinking about the hard parts of being Black and a woman, and she didn't care what other people said about her. She was busy trying to get at all the good stuff life had to offer. Celebrate your Black girl life. Celebrate us. Be like Zora and get that oyster, girl.
Yes, that was beautiful. Oh, thank you. See, that is just a snippet, a sneak peek of what is in Dear Black Girl. And I'm just so excited that we have you both here to share. And how many women contributed to the book?
It's more than 30. I should probably count. More than 30, almost 40.
So more, right. So we're getting all this wisdom, words of wisdom from Black women from around the globe. And like you said, inspirational with recounting of experiences, all of those things. So thank you for sharing. So we're going to keep it going. We're going to bring up two teens from our teen council. And the teen council is DC Public Library's paid leadership opportunity for teens. The council is made up of 8 members, one from each ward in the district. And their duties are split between working at a library in their ward and meeting with other members and the teen service coordinator. So we are going to bring up Tony Jackson, who is a student at School Without Walls, and Blair Mushala, who is a student at Duke Ellington School for Performing Arts. I got that right. I live here, but let me get it right. And Blair and Aishah already made a connection. I'm going to call it backstage. We were backstage because Blair wants to go into film. Aishah is a filmmaker, so I'm very excited about these connections. I'm going to bring them up so you all can have a conversation. Again, and people watching, if you have any questions, please put them up and we'll take audience questions afterwards. So I'm going to turn it over to you all.
All right.
Yay.
Hello.
Yay. Hello.
To you ladies.
Yes.
It is so great to talk to you ladies. So I wanted to bring up how you mentioned all these beautiful Black women and inspirational women that I've grown up to see, like Michelle Obama, and learn about Toni Morrison and whatnot. So one question I really wanted to ask off the bat is how writing with the narrative that you must take into account the white readers, or as Toni Morrison called it, the white gaze in your work, So I wanted to ask you, how do you write trying to avoid the white gaze, or how do you write acknowledging it, if you do, or if you even think it's a real thing? You know what I mean? So that's my first question I want to ask.
Oh, it's a thing.
It's a big thing.
Right.
It's definitely a thing. You know what? It's funny. I just had a conversation with one of my writer friends, Deisha Filia, about this. She wrote the wonderful book, Secret Lives of Church Ladies. And, you know, she agrees with me that the only gaze is our own. Okay. You know, in my writing, I center Black women and Black girls. And I am very lucky to have, you know, people supporting me and a publisher that allows me to do that. You know, right. I think, dear Black girl, I think, you know, there are some things that are just part of the human experience. And I think, like, the advice that was in Aishah's letter, there are things that, you know, non-Black girls can get from it, just as we are expected to pull things from books that are not about us. Right. As Black femmes, but in my writing, I write for us, and it would, if nobody else picks it up, you know, I'd be kind of disappointed, but okay. But if this book didn't work for us, then to me, that would be a failure.
Right. Right.
Yeah. I think for me as a filmmaker and writer, I mean, I studied with the writer and filmmaker, the late Toni K. Bambara, and she taught me in the 90s, it's the community that you want to name you, the community from which you come from. So for me, my work is Black centered. I mean, when I'm writing, when I'm directing, my audience is Black people. Now, what I offer is that our experiences are as universal as any other experiences. So I just think, like, dear Black girl, or the work that I do, that what we're just asking is that you experience these experiences through Black women's perspectives and lens and pen. And so I think that's that we're offering, we're shifting the gaze. Cause so often we have to shift to find some, I see me in that. And now we're saying, no, we are the center. We're centering ourselves.
Thank you so much for that. And I can say I really do appreciate it, because growing up, I didn't see too much of the white gaze, because I had Black women around me to show me, to look through a lens of an African-American woman, that lifestyle of African-Americans. So I appreciate that for you both. Thank you.
And also, again, on the topic of writing, how have you guys' upbringings, and I guess Indiana and Pennsylvania, those are both kind of very culturally different from each other and also from DC. So how do you think your upbringing has affected your writing, and has that reflected? Have you, like, taken that into account with any of your letters?
I think it may not be as culturally different as you think, because I grew up in Gary, Indiana, which is a chocolate city. It is 90-some% African American right outside of Chicago. So it's a rust belt city. It's a steel city. And I think I will always be grateful for growing up in Gary, Indiana. I was just telling someone the other day, that is part of what helps me center my Black gaze, because I grew up in a space where everybody was Black. So there was no, I can't be because of this, because everybody was Black. And I grew up in this environment where my schools and everything, you know, were teaching me about our contributions, whether it was in the official book that I received or whether I was getting it from my teachers and parents and things like that. And I think that was such a nurturing environment. And, you know, I come from a city that gets a lot of negative attention. But I will always love it. And I think it is part of what has framed me as a person and as a writer, that and being the product of the Great Migration. So my father and my grandparents moving from the South to Gary, Indiana, Northwest Indiana, to work and to live. So I think both those things are really important in creating who I am.
Grew up in Philly, which is very racially diverse, and there is a really strong Black presence. And my parents were and still are in their late 70s, really huge activists. And so I come from a really strong activist family. And then I've been really fortunate to be mentored by, like I said, Tony K. Bambara and also poet Sonia Sanchez. So I feel like for me, I had examples of how to do what I call culture work, how to be a writer, how to be an artist. And Tony K. Bambara was the first who told me, you know, the role of the writers to make revolution irresistible, to make invisible, make visible that which has been invisible. So, and then definitely influenced by the elders who are now ancestors in my life. My great grandmother, my mother's grandmother, was born in 1898. And she died when I was 25 years old. So just having that legacy, and she was raised by her grandmother who was enslaved. So just in terms of having that continuity and that connection, I'm really grateful for. And like I said, and also having parents who, you know, clearly, as I shared in my letter, there are contradictions and complexities, and also just them being really incredible activists and human rights workers. And so that has influenced how I move and the way I want to contribute to the world.
Wow, I really love that answer. And this is why we need to connect, because my whole family is from Philadelphia. So,
oh, wow.
And yes, my mom went to Girls High.
I went to Girls High.
See, this is why my mom was a girl, graduated from Girls High around your age as well, moved to DC after college, you know, so this is, we need to connect.
Yes, but, after this is over, we will connect. Because I'm like, wait, do I know your mom?
Yes. Oh my God, that is so amazing. And as you said, when it comes to grandparents and history, my grandmother, her grandmother was also raised by people who were enslaved. So I hear a lot about my history from her, and I take that into account. I love hearing about my family's history, especially because we have so many connections that you don't hear about often, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And when I was younger, I always felt like a lot of Black history was so far away, and I didn't realize how close it really was to home until I started talking to my grandmother more often. So another question I wanted to ask you, and back to Toni Morrison, because I love her, she also famously said in the late 70s, early 80s, that she was inspired to write because no one took the little Black girl serious. So I wanted to ask you, how does this quote resonate with you even now? And she said this in the late 70s. So you would think, you know, how would this still resonate with you today?
It's unfortunately still true today. I mean, it is maybe less true because it in part because of Toni Morrison, because she lifted her voice and did her work, it is less true, and there's space for me and Aishah and both of you. But it's still true. Like I am still disheartened by the ways we are left out of conversations, both about womanhood, femhood, and about Blackness. You know, we had this huge uprising over the summer about police brutality, and there are so many Black women and Black girls who are brutalized whose names weren't said. We talk about the juvenile justice system and the school to prison pipeline, and we don't say that Black girls are the fastest growing group in the juvenile justice system. And we have to watch a 9-year-old girl get maced in the face by police, and then we just let it go. So that is part of the reason that I continue to write and try to uplift the stories of Black women and Black girls, because I think we have to do that to be heard.
Right. Thank you so much.
And I think that there aren't, you know, there are so many stories that we have yet to even see or hear. So I think that we need more and more voices in terms of filmmakers, writers, journalists. And so while what Morrison said was profound in the 70s, it is equally as profound now. So even with all of the progress, and there's been significant inroads in terms of writing and publishing and filmmaking, there's still so much work that we have to do. And just echoing what Tamara was just sharing around, there's still a lot of, like, race is still in many ways synonymous with male a lot of times. And so that we still have to kind of disrupt that and remind folks that, you know, when we talk about violence against Black people, that we have to include all of the genders. When we, you know, when we talk about success, we have to include what the success look like in different ways. I mean, just as a result of COVID, we know that, you know, Black and Latinx women have just lost so much money in the workforce and stuff. So these are racial issues, justice issues. And a lot of this is awareness is a result of Black women documenting, writing about it, talking mm-hmm. about it. And so it is very critical. And so for me, I mean, I feel like, as I said in the beginning of my and Tamara's conversation, like Dear Black Girl is the book that I needed. So it's kind of like, I feel like it's the paying it forward. And so I just kind of see it like we're in this intergenerational relay race. So Toni Morrison offered like a clarion call. We're answering it. You all are answering it, and so on and so on.
Wow. And I just want to make sure I point out, because I listed all this negative stuff going on that we're left out of, it's also the good stuff too. Like, I'm looking at four like brilliant Black women on this screen, and we are not unicorns. We are not.
Right.
You know, and people don't hear, like, we are not uplifted enough in all of our awesomeness. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you so much for your answers yet again. Just something that I feel like I needed to hear too, along with the excerpts from your book. So thank you.
Yeah, law representation is definitely important. And I think awareness definitely has the power to affect people, like Black girls, people's perceptions of Black girls. It's very powerful. And so for Dear Black Girl, for you guys, other than your own letters, did you have a particular letter? You don't have to delve too much into it so people can still read it, but a particular letter that you read and you were like, wow, that's really, that it just stayed with you.
Oh, this is like picking between, I don't have any babies, but this is right,
like my favorite time.
It's like if I'm
gonna, I'm going to take the easy route out, but it's the truthful route. For me, I love Tamara's epilogue. For me, it is such a, I don't want to say manifesto, maybe a Black woman manifesto, like just that it's a wonderful literary example of unconditional love. Black girlhood and all of the diversity and complexity and beauty and triumphs and defeats, all of it. And that for me is just, it's something that I want to like mail out. I mean, the book definitely, but just that epilogue as just a gift to any Black girl that I come across, just to say, please read this at any time when you're feeling happy or when you're feeling down. You are not alone and we see you.
So I have two kind of answers. One is there's a letter by a woman named Nicole Jackson that's in the same chapter as Aisha's letter. And she writes that it was the first letter that I ever received for Black girls. And it was on the strength of that letter that is amazing, that tells this whole, like her whole story from being young and growing up in New Jersey. And you know, both of her parents were infected with HIV. It was a very difficult childhood to her experience today. And she wrote so vulnerably and lovingly and, you know, kept, and what the line I always remember is, she tells Black girls that I'm creating an infrastructure for you so that you can walk a different path, and I'm keeping the light on for you, and you are here with me in everything I do, and I'm there with you. And I just thought like that, like touched me. And then my favorite chapter of the book is the one on family, because so often people erase the love that exists in Black communities because our families are not traditional. So, you know, a dad, a mom, and 2.5 kids, and a cat, and a dog, and a hamster. And I want girls to know that if you have people who love and support you, then you have family. And I think there are so many letters in that chapter that really get like the different ways family can look and still be important and loving. I'm being attacked by a cat, so that's what I'm doing over here.
Great. I love hearing from you women and your opinions on these things. And I kind of noticed that both of your styles are kind of different than what would be traditional. And another famous playwright, George C. Wolfe, said that God created Black people and Black people created style. So I wanted to ask you, like, what is your particular style in your work? And is it colored by being a Black woman, or is it colored by, you know, the whole lens of humanity and womanhood? You know what I mean?
I think you all with your questions.
I know.
Better fit. I think yes, and I think it is like it's all the stuff that we talked about. It's my Blackness. It's my Midwesternness. It's my womanhood. It's my nerdiness. It's like it's all of those pieces of myself.
Right. Love that.
Yeah. I definitely. It's definitely my Blackness. My womanness. My queerness. I'm hardcore unapologetic feminist, my survivorness, all of it is in terms of how I, that informs everything that I write. I'm a long-term practitioner of mindfulness meditation and Buddhism. So really in terms of how do I come to the work and really see or strive to see the humanity in all, even those who cause, especially those who cause harm. So all of that I bring to my work and really try to amplify that in terms of, especially because I'm tend to look at very difficult issues. And so how do I do that with compassion and with compassion, with accountability and through a Black feminist lens?
There we go. You guys really are a reflection of your work, and that is so beautiful to see, especially as someone who is growing up in this day and age. I feel like it's so necessary for us to see women like you projecting your work. And it's a reflection of who you are as a woman. So I love that. Thank you.
So I wish for you guys to be able to, I mean, that's part of living free. And that is to be able to show up wherever you show up as your authentic self and as all those parts of yourself and not having to hide them. So that is what I hope for you both as you grow.
Me too.
Great.
Yeah.
Sorry, my computer froze.
But it's okay.
Technology. Yeah. So I am very into pop culture, and I know you both probably are as well. So do you have any films, TV shows, books, albums that you consider like a must consume, I guess, for Black girls, social activists, just anything, anyone that you really love and really influences you?
Ooh. Wow. I was like, okay, I wasn't prepared.
I love how you assume that I've been during this pandemic been watching like valuable stuff that I want to tell.
I know. That's what I was thinking.
Like, right.
Like, I've been doing a lot of mindless stuff. But actually, when I teach, I mean, I'm not a full-time professor. I'd like come in as a guest faculty, adjunct faculty, and all that. I teach Black women film, and I'm really into the classics. I mean, now it's kind of weird for me to call things classic, because to me, classics is like from my parents' generation. I'm like, oh wow, I'm kind of ancient now. So like I love. For me, like Daughters of the Dust by Julie Dash. A lot of people were referencing that when Beyonce's Lemonade came out, because a lot of the imagery came from that. So I like to look at contemporary work and see it as part of a continuum.
Yeah.
So I'm really, and then in terms of Washington, D.C., in terms of media, there, you know, we have a huge treasure here. Michelle Parkerson, who is an incredible documentary filmmaker, and she's done some science fiction films. And so I think about work like the of Michelle Parkerson, of Julie Dash, of Casey Lemons. Unfortunately, so much of this work now in this, you know, when I was like trying to look for films by by Black women and stuff. It was such a hard thing, but now because of Netflix and Prime and, you know, all these other venues. But though, in terms of like contemporary, like I enjoy Queen Sugar a lot. I'll let you jump in, Tamara. Let me think about some more.
So, you know, I was going to say the same thing you said about classics referring to literature. Like, I really like nonfiction. I tend to read nonfiction, and I found myself going back and reading like Black feminist, like mother, like Audre Lorde and bell hooks, and, you know, This Bridge Called My Back, and oh, what is the one? I can see the cover, Aishah. It's like voices of diverse young women, feminists, Black and white on the cover, different faces of young women, and it's called something. But I wish that, because I learned a lot about Blackness growing up, right? You know, my through my parents, and like they, like Aishah's, were very involved in community and stuff. I didn't learn a lot about feminism except by watching my mother as an example, but I didn't develop sort of my feminist politic until at least when I was in college. So I would like recommend picking up some of that early writing, because every time I sit down and think I have a new idea, I read some of that classic, you know, Audre Lorde's writing, and it's like, oh, she already thought of that.
Yeah. You know?
I think it's so feminist, like Brittany Cooper, who, like, amazing work, like some of the new women who are talking about these issues.
Eloquent Rage, Brittany's book, mm-hmm. Eloquent Rage. I think what's so important is that we recognize that definitely we are creating new paradigms, new thought, but we're building on it. So much of what we may think is brand new, as Tamara just said, has been done. And so that doesn't mean that you're not taking a 21st century lens on it, but I really think it is important that we understand and know our histories. Like, I think that that's so critical. Like, I talk about Toni K. Bambara in 1970, she edited mm-hmm. a landmark text called The Black Woman, which is really talking about race and gender. So in 1970, she was doing that. You can read that now, and definitely there's some dated things, but it's so relevant. And there are many, you know, iterations or versions, as Tamara just shared, in terms of This Bridge Called My Back, or But Some of Us Are Brave. But I think that some of those kind of old, those classic work, I think helps us to understand how we are here right now. Dr. Beverly Guy-Sheftall has this incredible anthology called Words of Fire, and it's an anthology of African-American feminist thought from like 17th century to, well, present day was the 90s. But you just see a wide range of writings and poetry, and you're just like, wow, people were talking about that. And what's my take on it now in 2021?
Two things. It's colonize this. And another contemporary thing that, you know, is pop culture-y, but also very feminist, and, you know, a lot of BIPOC contributors, is Bitch Magazine, and very much centered on young women, now edited by a Black woman, Yvette Dion. Lots of great articles, and I love the way that they dig into pop culture and help you kind of dissect it and deal with modern ideas.
And I feel that way about Teen Vogue. I mean, Teen Vogue has, yeah. I mean, that just really, I was like, whoa, look at this, you know? Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. Thank you guys so much. I don't know how much time we have left, because I do want to ask a few more questions, and I know she said we want to go up to an hour, so
I'm back there. No, right now you guys did get a good kudos. I want to put this on the screen. There aren't any questions from the audience, so if Tamara and Aishah are willing to stay and chat for a few more minutes, I would, you know, and answer the few remaining questions, let us know if that's okay.
Sure, I'd be happy.
I'm here. I would love to.
Yeah. Okay, sure. I'm gonna come out, and you all keep talking. It's awesome.
All right, I only have one more question for you, ladies. So my last question for you both would be, when, and if you're featured in a Black history book or publication, what would you want history to say about you?
Oh my gosh. Well, just one question. Just all one. Right. Heavy.
Lord.
Well, I think for me, there's kind of language that talks about being in the tradition. So I would like being in the tradition and being a part of a continuum. So I want to be recognized as part of a continuum of Black feminists, writers, freedom fighters, activists, who were committed to co-creating a world where all of us were safe and free from all forms of violence. So that's what I strive to do with my work, and just to really committing to creating cultural work that hopefully disrupts and ends, compassionately ends, forms of violence, centering Black women, Black girls, Black survivors across the gender spectrum as well. And that's what I would like for how to be remembered and recognized, about being a part of a tradition and continuum of making this place, society, world safe for Black people, and then by extension, all people, all of humanity.
Yeah, that's a great answer. So necessary.
I love that. What she said, and I would add to that just to be known as a storyteller of the Black femme experience, mm-hmm. and that I uplifted Black women and their stories as a pathway to get us free.
Woo,
got it.
What she said too. What she said.
And hopefully the other piece that I've kind of brought in over the last, I got my 200-hour yoga certification last year. And I did that because I wanted to use it, because all of that thing, the philosophy, the breath work, the meditation, you know, that's why I was like, we need to talk, Aishah. Like that is part, like heal it, the healing that is, I want to be part of healing Black women, so that we don't carry forward trauma. And
I'm so glad you said that, because now I got to, because I'm now as what Diana said in my intro, I'm in a 2-year mindfulness meditation teacher training program, and I have been a practitioner of Buddhist meditation for 18 years. So just in terms of just dovetailing what Tamara's sharing, is like, that's part of the work, is the healing, the work, because it's not just about ending the violence. It's also about how do we heal from it, an intergenerational trauma.
Okay. Thank you so much. So, well, I appreciate you guys hanging around answering my questions. Tony, if you had anything else you wanted to add?
I don't. This has been really great, very insightful, and also very fun. So thank you guys.
Thank you. What an honor. I feel really honored to be interviewed by you both. I haven't had this happen.
To be speaking to you. Oh my gosh.
Thank you. This is great. This is so great.
Yes. Awesome. You all do have one question from Lenora. Thank you, ladies, for your service. It's such an amazing conversation to listen and learn from. Are you ladies offering writing mentorships for young women?
I'm presently not. I'm not yet, but that's a great idea. But
I do. So I co-founded, along with a wonderful woman named Ebony Chappelle, a Black Women's Writing Society. And over last year, normally we would just meet in our fantastic library here in Indianapolis. But of course, with COVID, we couldn't do that. So it's gone online. So if people go to Facebook and look for Black Women's Writing Society, we gather on the second Tuesday of every month. And what we do is make space for Black women, make time, because very often we don't carve out time to do things that we love, like writing. We also have a little bit of education and opportunity for Black women to share their work.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. Well, Tamara, we know your book, Dear Black Girl, is out. So you're on I'm assuming, virtual book tour. Do you have any upcoming programs or events you want to shout out? Aishah as well. Are you doing anything you want to share with people?
Go ahead,
Tamara. Oh, sorry. I do. I had to pull up my calendar, go, wait a minute, where am I? My next book event is tomorrow, and I hope everyone will join us. It's with Loyalty Books in Silver Springs, which is not far from you guys. But if you go to their page, you should be able to find a registration link. It is tomorrow evening at 6 p.m., and it's with Rochelle Riley, who is a wonderful writer and longtime columnist for the Detroit Free Press. She has a new book. She is a contributor to Dear Black Girl, who has a wonderful letter on being raised by her grandparents. She also has a new book out called That They Lived. So we will be talking tomorrow for Loyalty Books in Silver Springs, and go to their website to both, if you want to buy the book, support your local independent booksellers and your local library.
Yeah. I have an event. So if you go to facebook.com, They Carried Us, I will be making my film available for it's a screening for a week starting on Friday, the April 26th to April 2nd. And this is in preparation for another Women's History Month event that's happening with my mother. We'll be talking about the film on March 31st at 7 p.m. And that's going to be on a Facebook Live. And again, the Facebook Live page is They Carried Us, C-A-R-R-I-E-D. So you can be able to see the film. You don't even have to pay the dollar rental free from Friday, this coming Friday to the following Friday. And then engage in a conversation with my mother, an intergenerational mother-daughter conversation. And They Carried Us is a book about Black about Philadelphia Black women's leaders from 1694 to present day, and both my mother and I and other many, it's 400 pages of Black women are featured in the book. So that's the event.
Oh, you know, can I add one more thing that I forgot? See, this is how my life is going. Tonight at 8 p.m., if you go to Centering Sisters on Facebook, it's a bi-weekly video cast I have with Dr. Tiffany Monford Dent and Dr. Carolyn Strong. And we will be discussing Black women and incarceration at 8 o'clock this evening.
Yes, such an important conversation. And yay, Dr. Tiffany Dent.
She's awesome. And last thing I have to say is, Blair and Tony, this is hands down the best interview I have ever had. And
really? Y'all are. I mean,
so far, you guys are awesome.
I'm telling you, I'm in good hands with the future.
Right.
You all, I'm in good hands. I was like, I can just kick back and sail on. Thank you both.
So flattered. Thank you so much. It's been inspiring talking to you both, honestly, truthfully. I love hearing. I can't wait to read the book. And thank you so much for this conversation.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you everyone for joining us. Tamara, Aishah, Tony, Blair, thank you all for watching. We hope you've enjoyed this program, that you've been inspired, that you've been educated. Like Aishah just said, you've been encouraged about the future. I had envisioned an intergenerational conversation, and I think this was wonderful. You all brought it, each one of you. So thank you for your thoughts and for your comments. Happy Women's History Month to everyone. Enjoy your evening. Good night.
Thank you.